Thank you very much for that introduction. And I'll be talking about stem cells and regenerative medicine. And this is just a cautionary statement about forward-looking statements. And as you all may be aware, there are two major hurdles in regenerative medicine, namely the problem of immune rejection and tissue shortage. And in addition to the shortage of whole organs such as heart and kidneys, there are literally hundreds of diseases caused by tissue loss or dysfunction. And with the advent of pluripotent stem cells, we now have a way to bypass, hopefully, both of those hurdles. So pluripotent stem cells are the body's master cells. They basically are immortal. They can grow forever. So for instance, from a single cell, we've created an entire master cell bank that could literally treat everybody on the planet. And they're also pluripotent, which means that they can turn into virtually every cell type in the body. That includes insulin-producing cells, cardiac cells. Okay, great. And again, virtually every cell type in the body. So the first pluripotent stem cell applications are likely to be in the eye and the central nervous system. And the reason for that is twofold. These are immune privileged sites. That means that the response to transplanted tissue is attenuated. And secondly, of course, there are major disorders that affect these organs. In the eye, vision loss costs literally up to $3 trillion worldwide. In the US, by 2050, it's expected to be over $700 billion for visual loss. In the central nervous system, neurodegenerative diseases are expected to cost over $1 trillion by 2030. And in the U.S., all sorts of other disorders such as multiple sclerosis, strokes, Parkinson's, literally are going to cost the U.S. healthcare economy hundreds of billions of dollars. So at Ocata, we're focused on the eye. The first application we're in the trials with right now is for retinal pigment epithelium for macular degeneration, but we're also studying a number of other replacement cells, ganglion progenitor cells for glaucoma, corneal endothelium for corneal disease, mesenchymal stem cells for immune disorders, and also photoreceptor progenitors, which I'll talk a little bit about momentarily. So this is just a cartoon of the eye in the upper left. The light enters into the eye. It hits the photoreceptors. These are the cones and the rods that we see with. And underneath those are the layer of cells known as the RPE, or the retinal pigment epithelium. And they're the nurse cells. They basically maintain the health of the photoreceptors. So they transport oxygen. They recycle vitamin A and the photopigments, and literally dozens of other functions. And we've carried out the first two clinical trials in the United States, actually involving the use of retinal pigment epithelium derived from human embryonic stem cells. And we got approval from the FDA to treat two different diseases. One is dry AMD, and the other is Stargardt's macular dystrophy. And those are the leading causes of adult and juvenile blindness in the developed world, respectively. And so there's currently no treatment for either of those disorders. So this is a complicated slide, but basically what we're showing here is that these RPE, when they're transplanted into animals, actually can rescue the photoreceptor function and restore visual acuity to these animals. So in the upper left-hand column, you're actually seeing an increase in visual acuity in a dose-responsive way after transplantation of these of the RPE. And then in the lower right-hand corner, in those two green-ish kind of figures, in the far right, basically you're seeing a cross-section of the eye. There are no photoreceptors left, no outer nucleated layer. And then the one just to the left of that, you're seeing very robust rescue of the photoreceptors, 5 to 7 layers thick. And based on that, we got approval from the FDA to proceed into clinical trials. We're carrying out currently 3 clinical trials, 2 in the United States, 1 in Europe. We've currently treated 38 patients. And we recently published some of the initial data on that, and we've seen no adverse safety concerns. This was primarily a safety study. And then the figure on the right in the middle, you can see a dotted circle. I don't have a pointer here, but basically that's the injection site. There's no pigmentation whatsoever. And then you can see with time the increase in pigmentation. And again, these are pigmented cells. And what we saw in these patients was an increase in visual acuity in the majority of the patients. and we didn't see that similar improvement in the fellow eyes that were untreated. And on the left, you can see some series of little white arrows, and you can actually see a nice monolayer of RPE that is attached to Bruch's membrane. And that actually, you can actually look into the eye in real time and actually see what's going on. So these are the results that we published. On the left, these are the results for AMD. And what you're seeing in the blue dotted line are the untreated eye, the fellow eye. And you can see at 6 months and a year, there was no improvement in visual acuity. So what we're doing is we're measuring visual acuity over the baseline. But in the dotted line, the eyes that were treated, there was about a 15-letter improvement in visual acuity. That's about 3 lines. We saw a similar improvement in the Stargardt's patient on the right, again, about 3 lines improvement. But this doesn't really capture the improvement that's made in the quality of life of these patients. So these patients can now, you know, read their computer, read their watch. They're able to go to the mall or the airport alone. One of the patients was a cowboy from Kansas who actually had 20 over 400 vision in one eye, legally blind. When we treated it a few months later, it was 20 over 40, and he could even ride his horses again. Just a couple weeks ago, we published another study. This was actually a confirmatory study that was actually done in South Korea. So this is the first pluripotent stem cell study carried out in Asian patients. In very similar results, we saw anywhere from a 9 to 19 letter improvement in 3 of the patients, and in the remaining 4th patient, just a 1 letter improvement, so it was basically stable. So again, importantly, it was a safety study, no teratomas, no ectopic tissue, no adverse events related to the transplanted tissue. But in addition to this RPE program, the advantage of using these pluripotent stem cells is you can, again, can turn them into every cell type in the body. So we've turned them into a number of different cells that are of importance in the eye. So for instance, we can turn these eye progenitors into retinal ganglion cells or into mature photoreceptors. So this is a study we just recently carried out. Where we actually were able to restore vision to completely blind animals. So in contrast to the RPE study where we're trying to prevent the progression of the disease, these are animals that are completely blind. They have absolutely no photoreceptors left. There's no outer nucleated layer after 3 weeks. So we waited till 10 to 12 weeks later, and we injected some of our photoreceptor progenitors into these animals. And then we look to see what they might do in terms of function. So there are 2 types of tests that we can carry out. The first in the upper left is what's known as an optomotor test, where you can actually put a mouse into a drum that has these vertical bars that can rotate to the left or the right. And so you can test the visual acuity on either the transplanted eye or the untransplanted eye. And then in the lower, you can see a chamber. This is for light avoidance. So you put the mouse into the light chamber, and there's a little aperture, and you want to see whether he will try to avoid the light and go into the darkened aperture. And it turns out that 3 weeks after transplantation of these photoreceptor progenitors, a very significant improvement in both the optomotor response, that is the visual acuity, as well as in light avoidance behavior. And it was a very strong correlation with the improvement in visual acuity with the number of surviving transplanted cells. We've also studied another interesting type of a cell known as the mesenchymal stem cell. We've discovered a way of generating these through what's called a hemangioblast intermediate, so we can actually get very large numbers of these. And it turns out that we can get 4 to 5 orders of magnitude more than you could get from the normal source, which for instance would be bone marrow. And this is just shows you the power of these cells, extremely potent. This was a study we published not long ago in a mouse model of multiple sclerosis. And so what you're seeing in that figure is a clinical score. So at the number 2, that's where they're starting to drag their hind limbs. At 4, they're completely paralyzed. They can't move. And as you can see, the untreated animals in those graphs basically are all paralyzed with time. One injection of these MSCs, and these animals are able to basically move around, jump around quite normally. And you actually see the moving animals. The one mouse that isn't moving is untreated, and the animal that got an injection of the MSCs is able to move normally. Oh. Okay, let's see. Okay, great. So we also wanted to test these in some other animal models. So another serious medical disorder, obviously, is lupus. This is a disease that affects anywhere from over 300,000 to 1.5 million Americans. There's basically no treatment for this autoimmune disorder. And about 50% of these patients actually get lupus nephritis kidney failure. And what you're seeing in the figure in the lower left is you can see a glomerulus that's from a healthy patient. And the one next to it, you can see is the diseased glomerulus where the immune complexes have clogged it up. And then you see the graph with the green, red, and blue. And these are animals that get lupus spontaneously. And you can see in the red, these animals start to die very rapidly when they're untreated, very much, very similar to humans in terms of the disease process. And one or two small injections of these cells, and we were able to prevent the animals from dying. But also importantly is that the lupus nephritis, you get kidney failure. In the bar graph in the far right, what you're seeing, the first bar actually is animals that were untreated. So what happens is when you lose your kidney or it gets diseased, protein starts to leak into the urine. That's known as proteinuria. And you can see quite a bit of that in the untreated animals. And then in the far right bar, you can see with a couple small injections of these cells, we were able to prevent that pathology in the kidney. We also looked into some animals that got severe Alzheimer's disease, and what we were able to see was just even a systemic injection of these, not even intrathecal into the brain, we found that the animals, we were able to cut the number of amyloid plaques in the brain in half. So the next step will be is to see how that impacts cognitive function. And more recently, we also carried out a number of studies in dogs. Dogs get diseases very similar to we humans. These are large animals with sophisticated immune systems, so they're ideal to look at some of these autoimmune disorders. So German Shepherds, for instance, do get a disease known as anal funiculosis. It's an analog of Crohn's disease. And it turns out that we went into these dogs that were resistant to conventional therapy, which normally would entail the use of cyclosporine and other powerful immunosuppressive drugs. But they were resistant even to those conventional therapies. And we went into six of these dogs, and all six of those dogs went into complete remission. So that's just one autoimmune disease, but in humans, there are over 100 autoimmune diseases, you know, in addition to multiple sclerosis and lupus, you know, there's osteoarthritis, diabetes, the list goes on and on. But in addition, these cells, we know that they're likely to have an impact on other diseases such as kidney failure, liver failure, or even pulmonary. So there's a lot of applications that you could use these cells for. And in addition, these are immune modulatory cells, so you don't have to worry about immune rejection. You can just use them off the shelf. Another exciting cell type that we've been working on is something known as the hemangioblast. This is a bipotential cell that actually existed when you were an embryo. It became your entire vascular system as well as your immune system. And we don't have cells quite like that in the adult body, but with embryonic stem cells, or actually with iPS cells now. And by the way, iPS cells, you can now generate those from just skin cell or a sample of blood. In fact, Yamanaka got the Nobel Prize for that last year. So we can do most of what I've described here using those cells. It doesn't involve embryos at all. And so we can create these hemangioblasts, and they're very smart cells. And so it's sort of like a nanoparticle. You can actually label them with a marker GFP that's green and inject them into animals and see what they do. So in the figure at the top, what you're seeing is something called ischemia reperfusion injury to the eye, where if you apply pressure, you can damage the retinal vasculature. And if you inject these labeled cells, you can see the green within 24 to 48 hours, they home to that injured eye and start to repair it. And the little inset with the red, that's the contralateral eye. The cells don't go there, so they will only go to where they're needed. So if you have damaged tissue that sends out these chemical signals and say, help, help, these cells will go to it, whether it's a damaged cartilage or joint or whatever. Similarly, in the lower left, you're seeing another example where we use these hemangioblasts. These are rats, and what you're seeing is the hind portion of them. So you're seeing the teal in the leg with the blood flow with a Doppler. So that's the degree of the blood flow. And you see a little circle on the left limb. There's no circulation to that ischemic limb at all. One injection of these hemangioblasts, and you can see within a month, completely restored the limbs of these animals. So there were people, as we're sitting here at the hospital, having limbs amputated that in the future, the doctor will just give them an injection of these cells and hopefully restore the circulation. And then in the far on the right lower portion, that was a study carried out at the Sloan Kettering here in New York with Malcolm Moore's group, and we actually were able to go in with these hemangioblasts into animals that had severe myocardial infarcts and cut the death rate after the heart attack in half. We can also turn those cells, like I mentioned, they're bipotential. Not only can they become vascular cells, but we can turn them into a range of different hematopoietic cell types. So what you're seeing here on the left is a tube of red blood cells that we generated in the lab from these cells. They transport oxygen just like normal transfusible blood. In fact, we've made an IPS line from an O-negative patient, so we can now make blood that would match virtually everyone in this room. We can also turn those cells into very large numbers of platelets. Of course, obviously, there's a shortage of platelets, and they only survive for a few days. And these can be actually preserved, so we can freeze down the progenitors for a surge capacity should you need them. And they also are able to form clots and also incorporate into thrombi in animals, just like normal platelets. But in addition to being able to make all these interesting individual cells, we also have the capacity to reconstitute these into more complex tissues and structures. This is the area known as tissue engineering. And in fact, there's already being significant progress being made. This is a bladder, an entire bladder that was grown in the lab by Tony Atala's group. He's already using these bladders in patients as we are here today. And a few years back, we actually did a study with Dr. Atala's group where we actually made miniature kidneys. So in this particular case, what we did is, this was actually work that was done in cows. So we took a skin cell from the ear of one of these cows, or from several of these animals, and using therapeutic cloning, we were able to generate genetically matched renal cells that were seeded onto a polycarbonate membrane. So this is a miniature tissue-engineered kidney. And we transplanted it back into the nuclear donor animals. And a few months later, after we removed them, what you saw is you can see that yellow material that looks like urine, well, it is in fact is urine. These were actually detoxifying materials from those animals. And when you looked at the urine, you could actually see elevated amounts of urea and creatinine that had been removed from the blood of the animal. And when you did a cross-section histologically, you actually saw that these cells were smart and assembled into glomeruli, into tubules, and that they actually connected up in a unidirectional fashion with the polycarbonate membrane so that they could concentrate these materials very much like your kidney would. So someday in the future, you'll get into an accident, you lose your kidney, we'll just take a skin cell or a little bit of blood and we'll grow you up a new kidney. So a lot of exciting things happening in this field. Thank you very much, and I would like to thank the people who are doing this work, the people at Ocata and academic collaborators.